that we foresaw at the time. Now, since then, a lot of work has been done, industry engagement, led mostly by DTC. So we now welcome Margot Forster from DTC to explain a little more and an opportunity to engage with the defence industry skills, education and skills consortium. Please welcome Margot.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First off, I'd like to thank the Institution of Engineering and Technology for giving me the chance to come and talk to you about the Defence Industry Education and Skills Consortium. We're trying very hard to get the word out about what we're trying to achieve. And one of the main things that we want to achieve is to support the development of the future engineers. I am the CEO of the Defence Teaming Centre in my day job, but I'm the spokesperson for the DISC, which is the acronym that we use, so I don't have to keep saying that big long name every time. So we've heard from Minister Pyne about the naval shipbuilding plan and the expansion of the defence work and the desire to have as much of this work delivered here in Australia so Australian wealth grows. But to do that, we're going to need to have the workforce with the skills and the education needed by industry to deliver. One of the things that I am very confident about, that the DISC members are very confident about, is this is a tremendous opportunity for Australia. For Australia to build its sovereign capability and to build its high technology and advanced manufacturing base to this nation. We've got to make the most of it now. We've got to be prepared with the workforce to grab the opportunities that will be presented in the next couple of years. Building this workforce is going to be a challenge. The sheer scale of the workforce demand. We heard a little today about the 3,500 person expansion required just for naval shipbuilding. But when you take that into consideration alongside the demand for similar skills in the land domain, the air, the cyber, the space, ISREW, you bring all of that together in defence industry context and put it alongside the fact that the uniformed defence organisation and the Department of Defence itself is also reshaping the skills profile of its workforce. So we're looking at, in terms of the civilian and uniformed Department of Defence, 100,000 people. And they're upskilling that workforce at the same time as we need to build our workforce to be able to deliver for defence industry. It is a very profound challenge. We've got to be prepared with skilled and experienced workforce to meet these needs. And our response not only needs to be rapid, but it also needs to be a sustainable response. A response that prepares to renew an aging workforce and to bring a larger, young, new workforce into our industry as well. And when we are skilling and educating this workforce, we need to also ingrain in that education the ability to adapt to rapidly changing technology. The response needs to be one in which the industry and the education organisations come together in a coordinated way. And it was out of this awareness that the need for something like the DISC came about. It started with a group of like-minded organisations actually started here in South Australia. In fact, it started in the boardroom of the Defence Teaming Centre. We have a board, a very diverse board, industry, small businesses, medium, primes, education institution, public sector representatives. And our education director and myself and one of our large clients were sitting waiting for the board meeting to start, and she was complaining that she had just done a whole barrage of interviews for engineers and she couldn't find the engineer that she needed. And this university representative said, "What do you mean? We make the world's best engineers at our university." She said, "Yes, but you don't make me the right ones." And so out of that, we went, okay, maybe the industry should have a way of telling the universities what exactly it is they need. And so we decided to get a representative from each of the universities and the TAFE here in South Australia. And we went out to the site of this prime. And we were very fortunate. They sat down and spent several hours going through their workforce plan. And they mapped out what they needed for the next 15 years. And it was like a real light bulb moment. It's like, oh my God, we know what they want. So we took that away and we thought, okay, we need to expand this. We need to understand what every prime is looking for. We need to also take into account what the supply chain is going to be looking for. We need to then bring in the institutions that will deliver this and find a way of getting that flow of information. So we started the DISC. We then knew that it wasn't going to just be a South Australian thing. This is a national endeavour. So we went around the country and invited universities that we thought would have an interest in doing this. And we were really fortunate. We had Edith Cowan University from the West come on board and RMIT from Melbourne. We also brought in to our consortium, the Indigenous Defence Consortium. And that was a very deliberate choice because we needed to have somebody in our team that could constantly bring us back and say, right, we need to produce an education program that is inclusive of our entire population. And I'm going, and so Adam Goods, he sits at our meetings and he makes sure that we have the insight from the Indigenous perspective about how the programs need to be constructed and delivered and how the transition into the working environment needs to occur. So we made a commitment that we'd work together and make ourselves available to Defence to help address these skills gaps and to try and accelerate the expansion of the workforce. We want the work of the consortium to be guided and in fact driven by what the industry wants. And so thank you again for giving me the chance to come here and spread the word. So to set the scene and let you know a little bit about what the consortium thinks that it's going to be doing, kind of the projects that we're working on. Noting that it's still early days, we've only met three times, and we're still waiting for industry to really get on board with the engagement. But we're focusing on the pipeline. So especially, but not exclusively, young people opting to study subjects to achieve shipbuilding and defence relevant skills. And then actually, what can we do to then make them choose to be in shipbuilding? So Minister Pine spoke about a number of the initiatives that the Department of Defence and Department of Industry are working on, and the scholarship programs is a really big part of that as well. But we need to make sure these programs and these scholarships are fit for purpose. And so we're working closely, trying to work out what's required. The other thing that we're very keen to work on is the recognising that 4 in every 6 people who will be employed, particularly in the shipbuilding program, are coming from a vocational area, is we see real value in the ability to have a more permeable, movement between the two systems. So you might start your journey in vet, but we need to have a way to easily transfer to the higher education. Or you might start your higher education journey, and then to improve your employability and effectiveness in the workspace, you need some practical skills at vet. So we're looking at how we can do that movement between the two systems. The other things that we're looking at, to be more specific, is contextualising defence in the later years of an undergraduate study. So we're looking at cross-listed courses where content can be shared and the courses can actually be delivered online. We're looking at sharing resources between institutions. The provision of easily accessible resources in areas of interest to defence industry that will allow academics who don't understand the defence content to pick up a package and make it easy for them to deliver their subjects in a defence context. And we're looking at collaborating on an associate degree in defence technology. So this would be run jointly between higher education and the TAFEs, and it'll bridge the gap, as I was talking about before, between vet and higher education, and looking at graduates from this being better prepared for their jobs, but also the students can use the qualification to gain admission to and receive appropriate advanced standing in their higher education. So, as I said, it's early days. We're very keen to have industry reach out to us and tell us what they're looking for. One of the mechanisms that the Defence Teaming Centre has set up is it's an industry, a workforce focus group. So we have about 30 defence businesses ranging from Austal through to smaller businesses come together to describe what it is they want. But it's a two-way information road. So they tell us what they need, but we also use it as a test bed so that, us in splendid isolation coming up with great ideas about what's going to make it really good for industry, we have the opportunity to actually get evidence by sending the proposals out to this cross-section of industry and say, what do you think about this? Would this program work for you? And we're very lucky. We've actually had our first customer, one of the primes here in Adelaide, has come to us and said, okay, this sounds good. So we're going to come to you, we're going to give you a list of our requirements. And one of the key problems we want you to solve is that depending on the course and the individual, a university graduate, an engineer, comes in and it takes between a year and 2 years for them actually to become useful. And what we want to do is find a way to collaborate with the university so that that last year in the program can actually be a work-based, an amalgamation of work-based education as well as the education delivered in the institution. So we haven't solved that problem yet, but that's one of the things that we're working on. But that's basically what the dais is, and that's how we're hoping to contribute. We have positioned ourselves to be in support of one bid for the Naval Shipbuilding College, and we are part of the bid for the other contender. So we're hoping, regardless of who gets the Naval Shipbuilding College, that they will see that the DIASC is a cross-state, cross-education, with industry association support, with Indigenous support, and we're there to help be a part of the solution. So thank you. If anybody's got any questions, as long as it's not about how to train